once call you spoken word artist, but that doesn't capture the fact that you've moved now to publishing your poems in books. But a lot of us of my generation of Afi from when he was doing slam poetry, and slam poetry was what cool kids did, cool literary nerds did in the 90s. and Val also has been doing a number of other sort of works that aren't in the two books that I've circulated. The first is Song I Sing, which is his first collected volume, and the second is Thousand Star Hotel, which is the one that's most recently published, which he'll be reading from on Saturday. So that's a brief description of their careers, but how did you get to be the people that you are now? So maybe I could have T start then.
Maybe the first thing that led me to doing comics was I almost failed out of my MFA in sculpture program. I was in the wrong medium, it turned out. I kept getting in trouble for doing narrative work there. And it wasn't
abstract enough.
It wasn't conceptual or abstract enough. It was too narrative. What does that mean? I think maybe I should go figure out how to tell better stories. So that's when I started reading comics on my own. And it was also when I started thinking about other people who were also outsiders in the New York, like outsiders of the New York art world. Because I came into an art school in New York, like having no idea what it was about, thinking that I would just go there and learn things and become an artist. But like that, apparently that's not really how it works. Experience, I thought, I love art still, I think, and I'm going to try to bring it to other outsiders like me. I think that there are plenty of them in like the New York City public schools, and I was right. And so I guess I was also thinking about like, how do I make art for people in a way that like they can afford to buy it? That was really important too, because having a better understanding of how galleries work and how pricing of art works. I was like, no one I know can buy this stuff. So that also led me to find like forms that are reproducible, that are more affordable. So comics, definitely. And then like as a teacher of history and of art, and just like as someone who tries to explain things all the time to other people, I was really drawn to like the potential in comics to explain really complex ideas in a way that's like accessible to a lot more people, maybe, than a history book. So yeah, I guess it was just a series of reacting against things that led me here.
Great. Val, how did you get to?
Well, first of all, thank you to Sylvia for bringing us here. It takes a lot of pulling strings and organizing to do that, so thank you very much. Really appreciate it. You know, I come from a really large poor family. I grew up in a rough neighborhood. I'm the youngest of, the youngest. And there's a library in my neighborhood. As rough as it is, there's a library. And you know, like most kids, I wanted G.I. Joes or Transformers, Ataris, back then, Atari, you know, all of that stuff. But I came from a refugee, poor, working class family. And so to both avoid the bullying and getting chased in the streets, and also because we couldn't really afford these things that we were taught to want, I would go to the library, you know. And so I fell in love with books from when I was super young. I started writing in grade school, but like really like Dungeons and Dragons, Lord of the Rings influence type of stuff, you know, like that was what I was super into. Science fiction, comic books, super into X-Men, you know, like I didn't understand that I liked X-Men because they were like the people of color of comic books until like much later, right? It wasn't until high school I started writing poetry. And the reason I started writing poetry was I was a young Vietnamese American man in the hood, right? There was the first Persian Gulf War happening. My father was in the military before we fled. I have two brothers who are still in the U.S. military. They were sent to the first Persian Gulf War around that time. And so there was that happening in the world, but also Reaganomics and the first Bush, and so that meant the gap between rich and poor was great. And I didn't really understand it at the time. I just saw, like, holy shit, like, my neighborhood is devastated, right? And that was like crack, police brutality, gang violence, just depressed socioeconomics, all of that stuff. And I'm a kid from Vietnam. You know what I mean? Like, I was learning about, you know, it seemed like everyone in my high school was reading autobiography of Malcolm X. And because of the neighborhood that I grew up in my high school, there's also a lot of Native American studies happening too. But me as a Viet Asian American, I was like, but what about us? Like, you know what I mean? And that's when I started writing poetry, really, is trying to make sense of all of this stuff. And it was really bad. I mean, really bad poetry. But you have to start somewhere, right? And but that's really, it was a collision of all those things happening. And it wasn't all bad. Like, around that time, there was a, that's 89 to 93, and so, like, the you know, hip-hop was really, hip-hop been around for a while, but it became like a national cultural phenomenon during that time. You know, like, it started to become unstoppable, I think, around that, right? And also, like, all these interests in social justice movements, you know, the Black Panther Party and all of this. I didn't learn about Asian American stuff till I was in college. That's a whole other conversation, but there was good stuff too. So, and I joined speech team. That was the other thing. So I was 16, I joined speech team. There was a category called creative expression where you wrote your own stuff, and that's when I started writing poetry and performing it. So I actually came before slam. Not really, but I mean, I did. You know, like, this was before, like, YouTube and stuff, so I couldn't look stuff up.
That's really interesting. Now, I'm going to turn the question to something that I'm particularly interested in. Maybe those of you in the audience might not know where this question is coming from. So, you two are obviously very involved in Asian American issues and Asian American studies and activism at large. But I feel like there are differences between the Vietnamese American experience and the Asian American experience at large. So we think about Asian Americans, and we think, at least today, I mean, those of you who don't know me, I teach this, so, like, it's obviously more complicated than the 5-second version I'm going to say right now, but we think model minorities, we think Crazy Rich Asian, we think, I don't know, K-Town parties or something. Like, whatever images we see of Asians today seem to be flush with wealth, Gangnam style, flush with privilege, and flush with, if not whiteness, then white desire, or white adjacency. And then many Asian Americans, I don't want to say all, but many Asian Americans come as somewhat privileged economic migrants. So, American dream. This is not to say that Vietnamese Americans don't participate in some of those few things as well, but I think there's a difference. Could you talk about that difference from your perspective as artists and as people? Because it shows up in your works. I think the ways that you write, we can see as Asian American stuff, but we can also see it as very specifically Southeast Asian.
Sure.
When I say Southeast Asian at large, it's because Cambodian, Lao,
yeah.
Hmong also share some of these experiences with a different flavor. But then it's different than the Chinese, Japanese, Filipino, Korean, Indian version of that story.
You want to get started while I pull out my bad immigrant badge?
Yeah, sure. yeah, I mean, that's a really interesting question. You know, I think, so, you know, part of it is just how people are racialized in this country. We're racialized by, like, whatever current administration or, I don't know what you call it, psyche or ideology, how they frame us, right? And so, I think with East Asians, there's that idea, oh, everyone's crazy rich, but that actually obfuscates the fact that, you know, in the major cities, Chinese Americans are usually statistically the most at need out of all racial groups. Well, we don't see that, right? But that's just the impression that we have. I think for Southeast Asians, especially coming from the Midwest, like, Minnesota is an interesting place for Asian people, because the two largest populations of Asians in Minnesota are adopted Koreans, usually adopted into white families, and Hmong people, okay? And that's, like, the, like, polar opposites in terms of the, like, social, economic economic realities. So you have to understand that in Minnesota, the first large Asian populations that came were from Southeast Asia. My people, my family, Cambodians, Lao, Hmong, we were the first big groups. And so we're racialized there through the lens of war, like we, because they're like, oh, Asian people, you know what I mean? Like, and so we were the enemy. We were the enemy growing up. Like, I experienced a type of hatred from all different types of races of people in Minnesota due to the fact that, you know, like, oh, like, you know, like, it's your people's fault the war happened. I had a relative that died over there. Go back to where you came from. Like, all types of violence inflicted on, especially my parents, and other people of their generation. So, you know, the definition of refugee and immigrant are very different. Like, refugees, usually we're fleeing something, right? And we usually don't have, usually, generally speaking, we usually are not prepared to leave. Whereas the word immigrant kind of connotates this, like, an uprooting, but usually you're prepared to do that, right? Or it's almost by choice, whereas refugees, you're running from something. And I think that that's two very different socioeconomic realities.
Yeah, I'm sorry. This usually goes on my canvas bag. Putting it through leathers, like harder than piercing your back.
Yeah.
So I think that Vietnamese people today, you know, it's been 40 years since we came to this country en masse, and so we've had some time to integrate, I suppose. And so I feel like there are many Vietnamese Americans who can fit into the good immigrant group. Even though we definitely come from, you know, what Ali Wong calls us jungle Asians,
yeah.
other people just call us bad immigrants, sort of like the unwanted kind. And the reality is that most of America did not want so many Vietnamese refugees in the late 70s. But the president went against public opinion, so here we are. So I suppose, like, with that kind of history, there is an internal compulsion to prove that you're worthy of being here, right? And so I think that a lot of us perform the good immigrant model minority stuff so that people won't attack us, right? Like, reading about, like, your dad getting hit with BB gun pellets in his driveway, like, just fills me with so much rage. But it's exactly that kind of stuff that we were trying to avoid. So you have to perform being good students, you have to perform being good neighbors, you know, bring Asian food to all your white neighbors so that they don't treat you with racism,
right.
Basically.
So they don't see you as an enemy.
Yeah. But then later on, I think now that I'm in the comfort of a place where, you know, people come to my talks and things, and I am a professor rather than a student, or I just have a lot more privilege now, more power in my hands. I see the power of saying, whoa, no, these divisions actually aren't real. And while my family story fits in many ways, the model minority successful refugee story, there's a dark side to it, and there really is no difference between me and other refugees who came who didn't do that well and who are sitting in jail right now. Or undocumented kids coming from El Salvador who I taught in high school. There's really not that much difference, even though this is the law.
I think this has an interesting, what we're talking about has an interesting intersection with the team in the morning conversation we were having at Telegraph Common. So the title of T's memoir is The Best We Could Do, she can talk about that choice. But it's a really interesting one because you mentioned earlier that you thought at one point that you might title this Refugee Reflex, which is a phrase that pops up in the middle of the memoir about this desire to, well, not desire, but unavoidable reflex response to leave when things get really bad. Because you're always in that fight or flight kind of mode. But then also the publisher wanted you to maybe put in a subtitle that I might have put in my own words, something like, you know, our flight to freedom or something like that, which I think reflects a little bit of this desire to make Vietnamese refugees into not only the good immigrants, but the proof of the goodness of the American nation. So, because what you're fleeing into is not, is freedom.
Yep.
So that implies that what you left was not.
Right.
You know, that's an interesting debate, you know.
Yeah.
And also that, you know, coming here, you found freedom, but, you know, the racism that T and Bao talk about is on display in The Best We Can Do. And also, I think in the set of, I'm getting the two books a little bit mixed up, but I think in Song I Sing you have a set of Nguyen poems, which I think show a little bit of that, you know, the differences in the way different Vietnamese have experienced that flight to freedom. So it's I think these are interesting variations on this notion of, you know, American dream or the immigrant's journey, because
sure.
the journey is not voluntary, as you were saying, Bao, and the journey, as you were saying, T, is has a meaning that's not just America's good, which I think many people want the immigrant stories to have that ultimate meaning.
Right, because it helps them make sense of the world. The world doesn't actually make sense.
It doesn't.
So maybe this is a, I don't want to dominate the conversation. Let me just ask one more to get into the substance of the things. I know not everyone knows all of your poems and all your works. But,
How dare you?
because we're doing this somewhat backwards. We're having a conversation and getting to know you before we know your work.
Okay.
We're trying to sell them on work.
You wrote this memoir, T, not just to do these academic things that I wanted to say that it's doing, which is to achieve the dream.
I just Trojan horsed in the academic stuff.
Yeah. How was that process of sort of constructing the narrative? Because it's your mom and dad's histories as well as your history,
mm-hmm.
because some of it is a history that predates your, you know,
yeah.
your existence, which I think is always a very interesting thing to have to do. It's a memoir, but it's a memoir of the life you didn't live. A memoir of the lives around you. How do you deal with these tensions of knowing that the stories get told in a certain way? Either this immigrant success story, or as you were saying this morning, a Vietnam War story, which is very flattening, and the Vietnamese are always a peasant running away from napalm or something like that. You've got all these narrative demands around you, and you're trying to separate yourself from these strains. And it works a different way in your work, Bao, so I'll ask you a different
sure.
version of this question. But yeah, how did you craft your story knowing that there were other stories pressing?
I kept a lot of real estate for the stories that I did want to tell. And while I spent my entire master's final project deconstructing all of the narratives that I don't like, I only gave them about two panels in the book. And even drawing those two panels of American stereotypes of Vietnamese people was filled me with rage. And I'm like, okay, that's enough.
I don't know if this is the part that filled your fridge.
That's the one.
Because it's a memoir, T's book is mostly very personal. But here's an interesting instance where the personal intersects with sort of what, you know, I would call the world historical, where I know it's tiny, and I wish, you know, if I were better prepared, I would have had the whole book scanned.
entirety, so I can show it to you. There's a panel here, which is not T's drawing, but original drawing, but a rendering of a very infamous photo known in America as the Saigon Execution, which is a spy is executed by a South Vietnamese general. It's a famous photo. And so I think but it's also one that like feeds into this narrative like of who are the good guys and who are the bad guys. I know the text is really small, we can't quite see. I find a moment like this very interesting and shocking because you have 200 pages of T's very lyrical style, and you get to know her parents and her siblings and sort of extended family and other sort of host of characters through this style. And then suddenly you see this general drawn in that same style, committing this war atrocity, which then gives Americans this notion that you're killers, you know, you're part of this jungle that means death, spells death for Americans. So that was a very interesting sort of hard moment where like those worlds collide for me, you know, the things that I would know from elsewhere and the things that I'm learning about you through the narrative.
Yeah, I mean, hopefully that breaks down that barrier of illusion. What was it? The latest thing that Vietnam seems to be really angry about is Baudrillard calling Vietnam a metaphor and maybe an illusion that never really happened. And he's like, no, it really happened. We were there.
He said that about the Persian Gulf War, too.
When you have the intimate knowledge that is actual life experience with these photographs, with these moments, and you know some of the people in the photographs, or you know some of the context of the photographs, it's a very different reading than one might get here. And that's probably a good thing to carry forward, even as an American. You know, now I'm basically an American, and when I read the newspaper, I have the same limitations to my understanding of what's going on in Syria, for example. So I don't know. I guess the historian in me hopes that you can maybe look backwards at the way that Americans view the war overseas, like help us think critically about how media is used to manipulate the way that we see current conflicts.
And isn't so? You all know the photo, right? The famous photo of the execution. Wasn't that like the story behind it? Is that he was executed? A group of spies that were basically infiltrating and assassinating like people in Saigon, right? I'm not saying it was right or wrong,
right?
But that people don't have the story that the person who carried out that execution was seen as incorruptible and a hero because he stood against corruption, and that they found that I'm not trying to say it was right that he shot somebody in the head. Please don't take that away, but we don't hear that part of it, you know, like we see an execution of a helpless person, and that's obviously wrong, right? But we also don't know the context of what is happening.
What that person did right before that, which is, from what I heard, murdered an entire family in their home.
Right.
So, you know, while it should be a photograph about due process,
right,
maybe,
exactly, right.
It's not, it won a Pulitzer because South Vietnamese corruption,
right.
and it was
right.
A key piece in portraying South Vietnam as a country not worth saving.
Exactly.
And that was an excuse for America to back
right.
out of a big mistake that
right.
it had gotten itself into.
Right.
Never mind the damage that
right.
America had already done by
right.
interfering in another country's civil war and possibly even causing it.
Yeah.
And I think part of the media bias is that it was not that Americans did not kill during war or also questionable atrocities, but none of those were pictured
right.
In the mainstream media.
Of course.
In a different vein, Bao, especially your newest book, Thousands Trying to Tell, shows your commitments to other causes, which I think is something, again, that we don't associate Asian Americans with doing. So I your first book is very personal, and then the second one feels much more, I don't know, driven by larger issues. And I'm thinking of the poem that ends in There Was a Flame.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So Black Lives Matter, victims of the fight on war, are also the subjects of your poems, A Thousand Start to Tell. Can you talk a little bit about what changed between the first and the second book, and a little bit about that creative process?
Yeah, you know that. Thank you. You know, it's funny because I see my newest book as much more personal than my first one. And I think the first one, I wrote a lot of persona poems, like The Winds, right? Like, I felt like the first book of poems was, a lot of it was about trying to break down these boxes that I felt Vietnamese Americans were being put in. So in a way, that's personal, right? And that's just, I don't know what you call it, a personal spirit. But I did, not a lot of those poems were based on things that actually happened to me. They were more kind of like, I wanted to break out of like, oh, all Vietnamese people are Miss Saigon. Like, that's it, right? And I wanted to, I think, render the life of Vietnamese Americans more richly than I had seen in pop culture, if that makes sense. Or even in literature, right, at the time. And by the way, buy T's book, read it. It's really good. Like, I'm not just saying that because she's sitting next to me.
It's
really
good. Buy Val's book too.
It's really, 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 really good. When I was young, you know, I read stuff like Maus, which was great, and then later on Persepolis by Martine Satrapi, which was just brilliant. All during that time, I was like, when's the Vietnamese version coming? When's the Vietnamese version coming? And T did it. So she did the hard work. She wrote them all, you know? Like, so not all you have to do is pick it up and read it. It's really good. I think with the newest book, it's much more personal, but it's kind of contextualizing the world around me because I'm a father now. And you know, a lot of the poems I wrote in there, kind of going back to your question about the model minority, I mean, I think one thing that I've been kind of pushing back and which I find perplexing is I keep hearing from Asian Americans, it's like, oh, you know, Asian Americans, we need to be allies to other communities. And I totally agree with that. And then they say stuff like, because, you know, we don't really experience oppression.
Okay.
And I'm like, what? You know what I mean? I'm like, what? You know, and I keep thinking of like what I see my parents going through. I mean, my parents are still in the hood, okay? In fact, after this trip, I have to go back to my parents' house and help them replace a car battery, okay? So shit has not changed. But not just my family, but like, you know, like police brutality affects us too. Deportation affects us. These things affect us, and I kind of don't, I mean, again, it's the modern minority, and it sinks so deep that a bunch of us believe that we don't experience stuff, and that just is mind-boggling to me, you know. And so a lot of my book was obviously writing about that, but it's important to contextualize it because even though I believe that, you know, obviously I don't think we're the only ones who experience oppression. It's just trying to add to like a very, like a larger picture. Does that make sense? Two last things I'll say about that is, you know, my daughter, she goes to a public school that's 84% people of color, is 84% free or reduced lunch for the kids. So she's not sheltered either. But she's learning about people of color, she's learning about women, she's learning about every other group of people except Asian American people. Like literally, she's learning about everyone except for Asian American people. And I don't know if you all saw the meme that was going around that was like, Black Lives Matter, Native folks, this is your land. Oh, wait, it didn't have Native folks. It left out Native and Asian people, but it had literally everyone else. And that, I'm not trying to be competitive with other marginalized groups. I'm saying people don't see how we're oppressed. People don't see our struggle. They can see us when we're complicit with whiteness. They can see Asian American people when we're being problematic. And we should, and they should see us when we're being problematic. We should get called out for being accomplices to white supremacy. But they don't see us when we're not. They don't see our struggle. And the last thing I'll say that's kind of plugged into that is me and some other Asian Americans have started a new social justice website called unmargin.org. Unmargin.org. Come check that out. Catherine Fung, who wrote an article about Get Out. You know, there's an Asian dude in Get Out. And I think that he was supposed to represent complicity of white supremacy. which is great because Asian Americans, we do enact anti-blackness and white supremacy, right? But her point is like, why is that the only time we're represented in any of these narratives? Because if you look at history, you know, the Delano Grapes Rights, that movement was half Asian American, right? Filipino, right? But we're left out of that history because people only think of Cesar Chavez and Latinx people with that movement, right? With Malcolm X, you know, Yuriko Chiama was one of his fellow organizers and friends. She's left out of that history, right? The movie Loving, about interracial marriage between a black woman and a white man, in real life, Japanese Americans and the ACLU were instrumental in that campaign, but we were left out of any type of reference to that as a people. Does this make sense to you? So I'm like, yeah, we gotta examine how Asian Americans are complicit in white supremacy, but we also gotta realize we've always also been in the struggle, and people are not able to see that.
Right,
and
with all the people like Grace Lee Boggs,
right,
who's done amazing community work in Detroit with African American communities.
Yeah.
It's
so
American Revolutionary. Mm-hmm.
Right, great book. So unmargin.org, and just an attempt to look at the larger narrative that includes us rather than excludes us.
That's great. As a last thing, so we can cover a little bit of all the books, this is a really interesting book. I'm not a scholar of children's literature, so this is me maybe speaking more as a parent than as a scholar of this, but I hope y'all got a chance to leaf through it. What I thought was interesting about this, and I'd love to hear a little bit of the story of like, did you just turn to each other and say, hey, let's write this? when you go to, okay, I mean, there's movements, like we need more diverse books,
yep,
to try to expand the representation, not just at the college level, you know, at the
right,
canonical level, but starting out the stuff you're reading kids, you know, bedtime. And I struggle with this, because I want them to have people that look like them. But we're very Americanized, you know, and my children are multiracial.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't just want to buy the Chinese New Year, everyone's wearing a chi pao version.
Right.
I don't just want to buy the Indians all wear saris and
yeah,
celebrate Diwali version.
Yeah.
None of that's untrue.
Right.
And the characters look like them,
yeah,
but they look so much like something that's not American,
right, mm-hmm,
that I also am uncomfortable on that level, so
yeah,
that they can't see themselves as a different looking American.
Yep.
And so A Different Pond, as you saw, is very interesting because it's not like Vietnamese in Aldai's, you know, farming on the Mekong as they
yeah,
have for centuries. It's a contemporary farming story, fishing story, contemporary bodies, contemporary lives. You see the echoes of you know, working class immigrant lives,
right,
you know, refugee lives there, but it's not, you know, hit over your head.
Yep.
You know, the war is in the background, but it's not like war. And I found that, and I feel like this kind of book is missing in the, we need diverse books.
That's why I wrote it.
You know, okay. Thank you. So, did you guys start with this idea, like, or develop?
Sure, well, Bao wrote it long before I knew Bao, and the publisher actually contacted me, the art director and the editor contacted me. They wrote me an email that I ignored for a while.
Wait a minute.
Well, this is something, they didn't tell me who it was by. I knew of Bao's work, and if they had like mentioned his name, I would have been like, tell me more. But no, they, like, I'll just be very, very frank, like, you know, I get an email from a publisher I had heard of before, because they're smaller, right, and it's two women with white sounding names telling me that they have a lovely manuscript about a lovely Vietnamese American boy and his father going fishing, and I'm like, oh god, one of those stories. I don't know, and I was really like neck deep in finishing drawing my own book, so I told him I can't do it, I'm sorry. So they wrote back again a little while later, and eventually they shifted their schedule because they possibly, and then when they sent me the manuscript, I was like, oh, actually, this is really good. This is different than what I was expecting. And then I asked them, one, I asked them what their budget was, and two, two, I asked them who the author was, and all of those things fell into place. So I was really lucky.
And so what were you doing writing a children's book?
Yeah, so
all by yourself without an illustrator?
Yeah,
like,
so
what is that thought process like?
Yeah, so you know, so I have a daughter and we've been reading, me and her mother are not together anymore, but we're both Asian American and we've both been reading books to her since she was a baby. And it's kind of like you said, like I wanted her to experience as many different cultures and people and families as possible. So that meant, you know, families with two moms and African American families and Native and Latinx stories. But there was a lack of Asian American stories. The Asian stories were kind of like what you said, oh, lion dance, or like let's eat food in Chinatown, and like all of that stuff is, all of that stuff is mad important. Like I want her to see that too. You know what I mean? Like I want her to have all of it. But like you said, there was like no, there was no book placing people who looked like her in any type of American context of struggle or life outside of kind of like this model minority kind of cultural box that we're put into. I just wanted her to have a book about like refugees, because that's my family, you know? And I was encouraged to do it, and I won't get into it, but my daughter, even though, again, her primary education, her cohort has always been kids of color and either lower income and working class, she has shown that she does not know how to contextualize who she is as an Asian American person in terms of race, right? So examples are, she'll come home and she'll be like, Daddy, you know, Donald Trump is racist against blacks and Latinx people. I'm like, yes. That's not the only people he's racist against, you know? And I kind of list it. And then, and you know, the other day, it's kind of hard to explain, but there have been many times when she's shown that how she's learned about the racial history in this country is everybody except Asian people. And Asian people are somewhere else. And that used to deeply affect her psyche. She used to be quite ashamed of it, even though, like, her parents are me, and her mother is like a American studies, Asian American gender queer studies person. So it's not like she lacks that at home, but that's different from learning it among your peers, right? Like learning in a classroom with your friends who are also kids of color, so that they understand where you're from too. And so I wrote a book, you know? I was encouraged to write a book, and long story short, the way it works in the children's publishing world is usually the writers and the illustrators are kept separate. It's like once they buy a book, once they buy your book, they find the illustrator and they're basically like, we don't want you involved in this process at all. But Capstone, to their credit, was much different. They were thinking outside of the box. T and I talked a lot together. It was a really fun process for me. I hope it was for you.
Yeah, I also didn't know how the children's publishing thing worked.
Yeah.
So I didn't know that we were supposed to work separately.
Yeah.
So
I didn't know that either.
Yeah.
I was emailing Val constantly asking his advice on things. And they were okay with it.
They were super okay with it, yeah. So I had talked to a lot of people in the children's book industry because I was a rookie, and I was like, well, what do I do, you know? And they were like, first thing, you never ever ask if you can choose the illustrator. Number two, don't expect to work with the illustrator. Like all of this stuff, it's like very regimented and like very, they have a very set way of doing things. And fortunately, it was all not that way with us.
We just
did it.
We need to do more.
It worked out okay, right?
Yeah.
I mean, Val won the holy grail of children's book writing prizes. It's called the Charlotte Solotoff Award.
Yep, for it. And T got the Caldecott Honor, which is basically the illustrator version. So things worked out.
Yeah.
But I can't imagine, like, one of you not being involved.
Yeah.
Maybe, like, if it was just a random illustrator, really concerned about the racialization of the characters.
Mm-hmm.
If it was a random character,
yeah.
I would have been concerned about the excessive exoticization of the story.
Yeah.
So it just really fell into place.
Yeah, and credit to both T for eventually saying yes, and also and
such
also
a jerk.
No, I get it. And also Capstone, you know, like they asked me if I had a preference for illustration, which I wasn't expecting. I said, you know, it would be really great to work with a woman of color. It would be really great to work with an Asian American woman or an Asian American illustrator or an Asian illustrator. Could you just try? You know what I mean? Like, try to find someone. At least make an attempt. And they did, and they really loved T. I loved T. And when she didn't answer, she was like working on the best we could do. At first, we were going to move on. but the publishers were like, you know, I think we should just wait, because she's worth the wait. And obviously they were right. So, and you know me, I would have fought for her too, but again, I'm a rookie, so I don't know if I get to ask for anything. I'm like, I was just like, okay, whatever, you know. So.
No, but now you can have like a chain, because children's novels, children's books also work on franchises, so you can displace that Eric Carle Hungry Caterpillar and get your own thing going.
We're never going to replace that.
That's canon.
That's canon.
I don't know,
sorry.
Talk about phoning it in.
Yeah.
Okay, I see another random colored animal looking at me. This is my life when I'm not teaching. I've been speaking enough. I really would love to hear from you guys. So do you have any questions? Again, we're not presuming that you know the works. Just ask them anything about their beliefs, their lives, their causes, their values, their processes, their advice to you.
One of the things that strikes me about the work that both of you do is the really interesting ways in which you depict intergenerational relationships. And I was just